First, I would like to talk about a couple of slides or a couple of minutes on that whole changing context when we talk about. I think when we talk about critical issues in the water sector, we need to take note of the type of changes which is taking place in the water sector. I would broadly classify this into two periods. One is a period from independence to, let's say, 1990s. And I do consider 1990 as a watershed year. Not only for the water sector alone, but I think for the entire economy, there's a massive restructuring which took place, which has an impact on the water sector also and some of the issues. Maybe as a result of that or this type of restructuring has an impact on some of these issues which we are talking about. So in the 50s, I would say, for example, the 1950 to 1990, I'm sure some of you might have heard this word called hydraulic mission. In fact, hydraulic mission concept is not just restricted to 1950 to 1990. In fact, it has started much earlier. Especially, I think, from the colonial period onward, there was this whole emphasis on building up water infrastructure, whether it is dams, canals, irrigation systems, and type of thing, and the, right from the, the British time onwards, there was an effort to build up this. I mean, not only in India, but I think that was the period in globally this was taking place, the whole emphasis on building up the water infrastructure in a big way. So steady expansion of creation of potential and utilization, surface water, especially if you look at the couple of 5 years, I think the whole emphasis was on building of large infrastructure. I think Hirakud, Bakranangal, various other projects have been this, and driven by a perception that, you know, dams are the temples of development and things. And I think it's interesting that Sripath has, in a way, dissected the whole myth around some of these issues. But you find a whole lot of larger water infrastructure coming up in the first few decades after independence. Groundwater taking off in a big manner in the 70s, especially. I mean, you find a whole lot of subsidized, well, not only in terms of power tariffs and things, but I find a lot of banks coming very proactively to give soft loans to people and things. So you find the whole groundwater, I mean, the wells or other type of things growing up in the country. And so much so that today, groundwater has become the main provider, as compared to surface water, in terms of whether it is drinking water needs or in terms of irrigation and other things. We'll see that a little later. And we also found that state's responsibility was the, state was still held as the main, had this respond to as the main provider of whether it is drinking water, irrigation, it was the state or state-owned various departments which are responsible to provide the basic service, like whether it is domestic water or irrigation and type of thing. So state had a very different perception of its own role, which we find changing later. Post-90s, I think the one of the very watershed thing, what we call this whole LPG, that is the liberalization, privatization, and globalization. These are the three catchwords, which I think has radically restructured, not only, I would say, water sector. If you look at some of the new policies which came up after the 90s, which all have the mark of this type of a restructuring which is taking place. And also in other sectors, like whether it's social sector, whether it is health, education, and various other type of sectors, we find that this impacting quite a bit. Second, we find that there is a changing water sector discourse. I mean, there are a lot of new terminologies and concepts came into the water sector. I mean, for example, many of you might not be familiar with integrated water resource management, IWRM. Now, IWRM came as a type of a panacea for everything. I mean, it has been championed by institutions like whether it is global water partnerships, and they have a, understanding about what is this. But nobody really understands in different contexts what does integration mean. Now, for example, integrated water resource management, I would argue that had taken place even earlier, type of thing. When you have smaller tank systems, or if you have the system tanks in, for example, in Tamil Nadu, you find you have interconnected tank system. In a way, it was much of an integrated systems. Or the farmers themselves do integration of surface and the groundwater to a great extent. You look at any command area. Now, it is done in an unplanned manner. All type of things are there. But I think farmers at their own level do integration. Now, the issue is that integration of what? So I think this type of definition with an overarching framework, saying that globally this is the type of solution which should have, without specifically understanding how contexts matter in many of these things, became a type of thing. You also find discourse around water rights. In fact, I don't think before the 90s we had any talk about water rights to some extent. or water rights becoming tradable to some extent. Trading of water rights, basically we started with Australia or other type of countries and things where, like, share market, I can own water shares or water rights anywhere in any basins and I can sell it to anybody to make profits or surplus out of it and things. So there are a whole lot of these new concepts which came into the whole water discourse. We also find a whole lot of emergence of new institutions. Otherwise, by and large, water policies, the direction of the water used to be decided within the national boundaries to a great extent. But we find that supranational institutions, whether it is World Water Councils or whether it is, GWP, what you call a Global Water Partnership, they conduct this whole once in four years exercise. I am sure many of you or most of us might have gone to some of these World Water forums and things. In fact, they are the ones who are giving direction to the water policies and other type of thing, the way it is shaping up. There is increasing role of World Bank, ADB, and other type of lending institutions coming up, and especially India. If you look at World Bank investment plans, in fact, I think this stretch of, in the last 4 or 5 years, you find the investment seems to have doubled in terms of. So, and many of these borrowings, the various states in India takes also come with various conditionalities. In fact, if you look at some of the policy initiatives in Maharashtra, whether it's the 2005 Maharashtra Water Policy or even the Water Regulatory Authority Act, which came up in 2005, we can clearly find the markings of this type of borrowings which have taken, in which within the agreement, it is that there should be institutional restructuring, there should be more participatory management, water rights as a defined type of entitlements. And so some of these things have come into the whole policy and the practice because of some of these supranational institutions which have come up. And I think we need to talk about the type of language, the type of concepts, the type of issues they are bringing up. The third thing I think when we talk about, we need to note this, and I feel that within the NGO discourse, we don't pay attention to too much of this whole increasing importance of urbanization and industrialization. The 2011 census data does talk about increasing, urban proportion. The people who are in the urban areas have been increasing. Maharashtra, Tamil Nadu, I think a couple of states are already touching that 50% of people live in the urban areas. But I think urbanization is not only limited to growth of small towns or increase in the number of people. I think there is also much more deeper process which is taking place, which some of us call urbanization of rural aspirations. I think this aspiration, how they are changing. Now, even in the rural areas, people demand access to safe drinking water, which was not the case earlier. There are people demanding access to irrigation water today. There are a whole lot of movements which are taking place saying that the public irrigation systems need to be restructured on more equitable basis. So the hitherto who have been denied access have been demanding some of these issues and things. So I think when we talk about the water sector issues, we need to take note of these type of changing aspirations. And I do believe that whatever system we are talking about, whatever system of water sector we are talking about, whatever production system we are talking about, some of these genuine aspirations need to be addressed. It also brings the whole question of lifestyle and various other type of thing. And I think what Sripad in the introduction said about this whole preoccupation with 8 to 10% growth rate and through the industrial route. That has been also another area which has an impact on the water sector due to data. Where does the water go? Now, I don't think anybody has made an assessment of this whole Mumbai in Delhi industrial corridor which is going to come up. There have been a lot of talk about how much land people lose and displacement and things. But what is the water impact of all these type of things? Or the various SEZs which are coming up in the country? Or in places like Odisha, Chhattisgarh, Jharkhand, where larger dispossession is taking place of the Adivasi people, it's not only about land, it's also water. So this preoccupation of the industry is the only route for prosperity or keeping up to this 8 to 10% growth rate has been the whole motto of economy today, or the political economy questions I think we need to take note of. Fourth, I would say this whole concept of close-in basins. I'm sure some of you know what is a close-in basin. Or close basin or whatever. Any take? That is one, yeah. So once the entire water is, the flows are allocated for different uses and type of, there is no water which can flow. Now Krishna is a classical example, it doesn't reach the sea anymore. So that means that we don't have no more fresh water anymore to meet. Is it okay or you're finding it difficult? I'm sorry, yeah. I don't know, Sripad, you need to pitch in once in a while or?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah. So there is a whole issue of closing basins, which means that the water which is there, already as flowing water or within the annual cycles, are getting, I mean, every allocated for different uses like domestic water, industry, agriculture, and other type of things, and there is no fresh water anymore. That's why I think there's an EME study which says that, you know, they have done some 4 or 5 basins, and Krishna is a basin which actually doesn't reach the sea anymore in most of the years. Now, the issue is that if the river doesn't really reach the sea, then do we say that it's still a river or it's a dead river or what is it? So this is a very serious issue, not only for the ecosystem issues related to it, even for the growing livelihoods of the people to some extent. And add to this is climate change. I don't want to get into too much into climate change. There are sort of, but I think in the water sector, climate change is playing a whole lot of role. For example, I mean, this whole question of extreme events, how do you manage? Now, this year is supposed to be a particularly bad year because of, you know, less rainfall and things. So issues of increasing floods and increasing droughts is an issue of this. But the whole climate change argument is being used today to create larger water bodies. I mean, that is, I think, one of the important issues in terms of adaptation or World Bank reports and type of thing. If you see where they equate water security with per capita storage. No, and they're comparing that how much US has stored, how much China has stored, and how much we are lagging behind. So the whole effort is to catch up. So the climate change argument is being used today to create larger and larger water bodies in the name of water security. So I think when we talk about water sector issues, these are some of the overarching context that is shaping and reshaping the whole discourse around or changing the nature of the issues itself.